How you doing? Here to do another little walk, baby. We're gonna do Park Slope. That's right, the largest historic district in New York. Whoa. Before we get started, Stewie, how you doing?
Yo, yo.
Good to see you. Good to see you again. It's been a while. Eric's out of town. I've been going back to some old friends, which is nice. We're gonna be walking around Park Slope today. Before we start, guys, check out the Patreon. Huge help. That's how I fund these things, baby. Patreon is the game changer. That's how we're able to create stuff that we actually like. I don't have to pander to that algorithm, you know? Maybe I should, but anyways, there's extras on there, different levels, all kinds of levels. And also, like and subscribe, baby. It's a big important thing, but you know what? That's enough of the business. I just gotta get it out of the way. I think we should just do this, man. Park Slope's an amazing place, very beautiful, lots of beautiful buildings. We got a lot of cover today, so I'm just gonna stop rambling and Stewie, what do you think? Should we just do this?
Let's do it.
Let's do it. Okay, so let's start at the beginning here. So Brooklyn, the whole of Brooklyn really, was just one of six villages established by the Dutch. And Brooklyn actually started to spread because it was located right next to Manhattan / New York City. It was close, it was like the first suburb, and people came in, they moved there, and it grew and grew and grew, and eventually swallowed up the other villages. In fact, in this area, it was mostly just like, you know, 200-something families that owned farms, pretty much, like this one. This house is a recreation, I'll get into that. It's called the Old Stone House, and it was built by the Vecht family. It was from the Netherlands. And it was eventually bought by the Corteliers. Willem Kieft, actually, one of the director generals of the Dutch West India Company, bought a lot of land out here. He's famous for starting Kieft's War in the mid-1640s, which was actually a huge disaster, killed tons of Native Americans, and was one of the reasons why they replaced him with Peter Stuyvesant, who whipped the colony into shape, so much so that the British came in and took it right away from him. That stinks. But fast forward to the Revolutionary War, where the Americans got their revenge, I guess, on the British. And here was where one of the major battles of that war happened. I've talked about this before. I talked about this in my Brooklyn Heights video. You can check that one out. But the Battle of Brooklyn / the Battle of Long Island took place here in Brooklyn on August 27, 1776. It was the first major battle of the American Revolution. And the first battle ever of the United States. Ah, the United States military, isn't that cool? Because they declared their independence on July 4, 1776. The battle was like a month and a half later. Anyways, what happened was the British come in through Brooklyn and they kind of push their way up basically Brooklyn, up this end of Long Island towards what is today Brooklyn Heights. And they had to pass through here. But there was a regiment of about 400 Marylanders here at this little stone house holding off about over 2,000 British troops. So those Marylanders suffered huge losses. There were 256 killed here, and they were buried in a mass grave nearby. So now you got all these kids running around playing. There's a freaking mass grave nearby. Isn't that nuts? They're throwing the Nerf footballs, and there's some skulls underground just, you know, crying, I guess. Very brave Marylanders pushing everybody back. They're famous for more than just crab cakes. But they were able to hold them off long enough to get Washington and some of his troops time to back all the way out to what is today Brooklyn Heights / Dumbo. And then they escape under the cover of night on August 29th and are able to evacuate eventually and leave the city of New York for the British. But they came back in 1783 and booted them the hell out. So they won. But they almost lost. It was a lost battle, but it was still very important because they could have lost the entire war right there. And today we would all be speaking English, you know, that weird English though. So anyways, this is the old stone house. This is where it all took place. It actually was crumbled and they found some of the stones underground and they revived it. But it was a actual little farm. And unfortunately there were slaves here. You know, they had lots of slaves in this part of Brooklyn because they were massive farmland and, you know, you needed people to deal with the land back then. So that's what they had. So here around me is Washington Park also. And this was home, here's a little interesting trivia, in 1883 became home to the Brooklyn Baseball Club. Ah, they had the grand opening here and they beat the Trenton team by 13-6. I don't know if Trenton had a mascot or anything. Maybe it was the Trenton Trousers Snakes or something. But they beat them anyways. And that Brooklyn Baseball Club eventually became the Brooklyn Dodgers. Ah, and here's a little fun fact. Charles Ebbets started working with the Brooklyn baseball club early on, taking tickets. He was a clerk, he was doing all kinds of stuff. And by 1913, when they opened their new ball field, it was called Ebbets Field. And he became the owner of the frickin' club. So the moral of the story is, go get a job ripping tickets at a baseball stadium and you'll become the owner of the baseball team. It's a beautiful story. Anyways, that's just a little aside here, Washington Park, old stone house. Brooklyn and Park Slope was gonna keep changing. So let's go to the next spot and talk about that and why. Yeah. Okay, so one of the things that changed this neighborhood's fate was what I'm standing in front of right now. Now, technically, we're not in Park Slope, but it is related to Park Slope. So Brooklyn was, at least this part of Brooklyn, was all kind of marshes and wetlands, and behind me was what used to be kind of a creek passing through it. It was called the Gowanus Creek, named after the sachem of the Canarsie Indians named Gowane, and at least that's what we believe it was. And it was actually dredged up and created to be a canal. So in 1849, the New York State Legislature kind of okays this. And then this man, Edwin Litchfield, who was a railroad tycoon, kind of took over and made and saw it through because it was having lots of trouble getting done. It was finished in the 1860s. And it was this that kind of he used to then develop a lot of Brooklyn. We're going to talk about him in a second, a little later. But this is kind of what made this place explode. We're actually in Gowanus area, which is right next to Park Slope, but this is also what he used to kind of develop his neighborhood of Park Slope. Anyways, canal, right? Yeah, little boats going through. It's pretty great. In fact, at its peak in the 1920s, they had 26,000 ships and barges pass through here. Obviously, at the same time, they had tons and tons of firms and companies put their headquarters here. You had over 50 different firms and industries and warehouses and things lining this little 1.8 mile canal. Another thing you had, it was kind of disgusting, you know, pretty gross. They had, you know, unfortunately, the sewage from the area just dumped right into this area, making it a cesspool. Literal cesspool is disgusting. I mean, even in 1911, it was so disgusting here that they built what was called the Flushing Tunnel from the actual canal out to New York Harbor to just dump all the crap out there. And, you know, it worked, it served its purpose, I guess, for a little while, but because after World War II, the traffic of this canal had died down so much, in 1961, it broke down and they didn't fix it for like 37 years, which is pretty insane. I mean, just imagine if your landlord refused to fix your toilet for 37 years. I guess that's not that hard to imagine, you know, but that's what happened. Now, they've since done different things to that kind of emptying out in the canal, but when there's flooding from rain and stuff, it still goes out there. So, you know, that's decades and decades of all the shit from Brooklyn dumping into this thing. Pretty disgusting. In fact, at the beginning, you know, when they first came here, oysters were a really big thing here in Brooklyn. It was one of the big first exports of Brooklyn, oysters from places like this. You wouldn't want to eat an oyster from here now. Probably have, you know, three arms and horns coming out of it. But back then, it was a pretty big thing. So it was actually here that a lot of the brownstone that was mined in places like New Jersey would come through. So all the brownstones of Brooklyn, which is what this area of Park Slope is famous for, were built from it. This kind of powered the neighborhood. In fact, in 2007, I don't know if you knew this, Stewie, but a whale was spotted actually at the mouth of this canal. 2007, it was a baby minke whale, and they named it Sludgy. Sludgy, I guess a play on the word fudgy. I guess the Carvel cakes that are called Fudgy the Whale or whatever. Anyways, they called it Sludgy the Whale, and they saw him, like, you know, shooting out of his blowholes, really cute, and all, it was a baby whale. He eventually died after, like, a day. Let's go figure, he's, like, you know, inhaling, you know, human and also, you know, a lot of toxic stuff. So he died, unfortunately. But at 2010, very important thing happened. They named this a Superfund site, a federal Superfund site, meaning that tons of money was gonna come in to fix it up. Part of the Superfund cleanup, they're dredging up all the sediment that's been accumulating for decades at the bottom of this poor canal. I mean, I can imagine if you take a whiff of that, you're gonna be clued into all the secrets of the universe. You'll see God, you'll know who killed JFK, and you'll understand why people watch the Real Housewives TV shows. They're doing lots of different things to make it nicer, which is why now it's being developed. Waterfront property on the Gowanus Canal is what the latest thing is. which if you told someone 50 years ago that was happening, they would have, you know, punched you in the balls. But today that's what's happening. And, you know, this is what actually helped Park Slope to explode. We're going to talk about how this came about here in a second, going to the next stop. So I kind of hinted at this before, but a lot of Park Slope was kind of the vision of one man. His name was Edwin Litchfield. So this guy was a lawyer from upstate New York. Yeah, that's right, a lawyer. Yeah, I used to be a lawyer. Okay, it's pretty embarrassing. I haven't done as much as Edwin Litchfield, but he was a lawyer from upstate New York. He became a railroad tycoon, had a lot of dough. And he came here to New York City, and he actually started by funding a lot of the Gowanus Canal, and then he bought up a lot of the land here in Park Slope. In fact, 3rd Street was going to be kind of the driveway to this property here that he had bought for himself, where he built this. This is the Litchfield Villa. Very fancy. This is where he lived. It was finished in 1857 and designed by Alexander Jackson Davis, who also designed the Federal Hall National Monument down on Wall Street and Broad. I've talked about that in a Lower Manhattan video. Okay, great. But this is actually his property. He had 50 acres around it. There was a greenhouse, chicken coop, all kinds of crazy stuff. And he lived here. But he was the guy who kind of pushed for the Gowanus Canal. He kind of, you know, sold off and partitioned off a lot of this land, and it was kind of just his vision, you know. All the fancier houses here closer to the park, and then down near the Gowanus Canal was going to be all that industry. Although today it's all kind of pretty much fancy, but it was what kind of what he had planned out. This house was very beautiful at the time. Actually, it didn't have brick before. It was actually stucco. Mon Company actually did some of the tiling here, and they just finished the U.S. Capitol, so they say they used a lot of the U.S. Capitol, extra tiles from the U.S. Capitol on this thing. Kind of interesting. He'd actually taken the idea to develop Park Slope a lot from what had happened in Brooklyn Heights with the Pierpont family having developed a lot of that area. So he knew what he was doing. He knew that this was where the money was at, and he was very smart. He lived here, actually, until his death. The city took the land around the house in 1869 for Prospect Park, which I will talk about briefly in a little bit. But he lived here until 1885. He actually traveled around a lot towards the end of his life because his wife passed away, and he actually nicknamed this Grace Hill after his wife, Grace. So when Grace passed away, what's the point of staying here, right? That's true love. Today, this is home to the Parks and Rec of New York. How you doing? And also the Prospect Park Alliance. And the house has actually been appraised at being worth $86 billion. But a pretty little house. Edwin Litchfield kind of got the ball rolling here in Park Slope. I say we talk a little bit more about how that ball kept rolling in our next stop. Let's go. Okay, so now I'm here at, Grand Army Plaza, basically at the top, the north end of Prospect Park. Holy crap, this is kind of what really blew the neighborhood up. Really smart little park that Litchfield was able to capitalize on, etc. It was opened in 1867, but also it didn't really completely finish until 1873, but it was designed by the same designers of Central Park, Frederick Law Olmsted and Calvert Box, huh? You can learn more about them in my Central Park video. There you go. But we're actually here at the north end. This is Flatbush Avenue, which used to be actually a Native American trail. And it actually basically leads down here to the park. In the middle here is Grand Army Plaza. Very beautiful little arch. Pretty cool. It was actually built in 1892. The actual sculptures were put there in 1895. Very important to remember, the sculpture is a very big part of the City Beautiful movement. The architecture that accompanied the City Beautiful movement. They were out of there in 1895, and in fact, in 1976, the winged woman on the chariot fell off, just fell off the chariot, and yeah, it kind of shows you where New York was at the time, but it's been, since been built up. So Prospect Park is 526 acres, a little smaller than Central Park, but Olmsted has said that he actually learned from his mistakes on Central Park and made this one really nice. It was also here that when all the trolleys and cars and things were kind of making their way in the early 1900s. They actually installed a death-o-meter briefly here. The death-o-meter, to tell you how many people have been killed in car accidents. It's like, actually said death-o-meter. It sounds like a rejected Price is Right game, but they had it here in the middle of the thing. They moved it actually from a different part of Brooklyn. So this has always been kind of like a little center. You see the public library, you see the little Corinthian columns there as well. And then the park just kind of continues down. So here, Prospect Park West is what they called the Gold Coast. That's where all the rich people here in Brooklyn lived. They have their nice little places. That's where the Litchfield, you know, villa is. You also have a statue over there. It's kind of interesting. It's Henry Slocum. That's General Slocum from the Civil War. That's who they named the General Slocum boat after that sank in 1906. I talked about this in my East Village video. Pretty cool. Yeah, talked about a lot of this stuff in other videos. You're gonna have to click on the link or whatever the heck and watch those. But but this is one of the things that really blew up the neighborhood, and Park Slope is the slope that leads up, you know, elevates up to the park. Park Slope. Ah, look at that. So anyways, we gotta keep moving, man. We got a lot of cover. Let's go. Okay, I'm just here totes cash lying against the railing and not weirding anyone out at all. But I'm here to tell you how the Lenda 1800s, this neighborhood really started to take off, hit its heyday. Remember, the Gilded Age was kind of in full bloom. New York City's booming. Money was coming here. They were building mansions. They were building clubs. In 25 8th Avenue, which is a little further up the block, you have the Montauk Club built in 1891. Very beautiful building that's still there. Behind me, you have one of many mansions that were built here. This one was built by the Adams family, Cadbury Adams, who invented Chiclets. So they call this the Chiclets Mansion. Oh, isn't that cool? I wonder if after building it, the mansion, like its namesake, lost all of its appeal after 30 seconds. Huh? But no, it actually turned into apartments when the neighborhood went downhill, which we'll talk about a little later. And it was recently bought and renovated and everything. It was bought for like $5.5 million, which is actually kind of a deal for this thing, believe it or not. And now it's a really fancy mansion. Still called the Chiclets Mansion, though. I guess it's kind of an asterisk. I wouldn't care. I'd live in the Sour Patch Kids Castle for, you know, if it was a $5.5 million place with nice. All right. Anyways, pretty building. A lot of stuff here on 8th Avenue, but neighborhood keeps changing, baby. We're going to go to the next stop, talk about it some more. All right, so this is a quick little aside. I know we've talked about other stuff, but I have to mention this because if you're in this neighborhood, you have to know this thing happened. I'm actually on Sterling Place. This is 121, 123, 126. I'm standing right where, on December 16th, 1960, a freaking plane crashed right in the middle of the street. Just plopped down. 85 person flight, 826 United. It was a DC-8, just fell down. So what happened was this plane was flying from Chicago to New York, and it clipped a TWA flight. The wing clipped the top of the fuselage. There's a little SAT word for you. And unfortunately, the TWA flight got the brunt of it, so it basically went straight down into a field in Staten Island. Not just any field, a field in Staten Island to make things worse. And actually, the field eventually became New Dorp High School. Kind of crazy, right? Dorp is actually, I think, the last words that the captain said before crashing the plane. Sorry, that was a little mean. Anyways, New Dorp High School, also where Method Man went to high school. How about that? That's a little fact there, Stewie, huh? You know Method Man?
I know Method Man.
M-E-T-H-O-D, man. Anyways, the other plane came over here, Flight 826, and it crashed right in the middle of this street. Just completely destroyed a church, which, you will not believe this, was named the Pillar of Fire Church. Yeah, it doesn't get much more ironic than that. Actually, a guy who was a sculptor lived in one of the houses here and salvaged some of the iron and made some of these little gates here using that iron. It's kind of cool. But you can still see on the buildings here on 121, you can see where the facade, the bricks had to be replaced. And up here at the top of 123 and 126, you can see also where they had to be replaced as well. So, you know, there's still some little things you can point out. When you walk down here and you want to bum someone out about the story of the plane that crashed here, you could show them these things. Happened all here on Sterling Place in Park Slope. That's insane. A plane crash right in the middle of this thing. Just a little aside, by the way, this is 1960. 1958, there had been a huge collision, a mid-air collision over the Grand Canyon. And so this was a big deal. And in 1960, actually, they began the whole process of implementing the FAA and rules and air traffic control and all that stuff. And since then, there's only been 3 collisions in the entire world and none in the U.S., but they were happening all the time at this point in time, which is kind of wild if you think about it. All 85 people on the plane died, but there was one survivor, actually. His name was Stephen Baltz. He was an 11-year-old kid who was given a trip to New York from Chicago by his parents to celebrate his 11th birthday. Pretty messed up. He's probably wondering, Mom, why couldn't you just give me a G.I. Joe, huh? Why do you have to send me on a plane? But anyways, he actually is ejected from the plane when the plane crashes, and he survived. So they were able to, you know, kind of like bring him back to, he gave interviews from the hospital where he was taken, but unfortunately he died the next day of pneumonia from being out in the cold on a snowbank, everything. But they actually made a plaque, a memorial to him with the coins that he had in his pocket. I think it was like 65 cents, and they still have that plaque at Brooklyn Methodist, which is kind of interesting. But a really tragic story, you know, he was the one lone survivor of the whole thing. And actually also pedestrians were killed by this thing. As you can imagine, a plane crashing in the middle of the thing. That's a bad day, man. You're walking around and you just have a plane fall on your head. But, you know, pretty wild that it happened right here in the middle of Park Slope. Anyways, that's the story. That's a little digression. Let's keep moving. Okay, so after World War II, the story of Park Slope was similar to the stories of a lot of neighborhoods in New York City. White flight, industry leaves the cities for various reasons. The unions are too strong. The waterways and railways lose out to highways. Land becomes cheaper outside the cities. So industry leaves. Where you got the Gowanus Canal right nearby, that's a big deal. And also the people in the neighborhood leave. They go to the suburbs. Bigger, you know, spaces, cheaper land. So these places become dilapidated. There's another SAT word for you. So this area throughout the 50s, 60s, whatever, starts to decay. But it's also one of the first to be, quote, pioneered by, you know, what you call, I guess, today, gentrifiers. People came and they saw these big, beautiful brownstones, and they were paying like $25,000 for an entire brownstone, fixing it up, making it nice, and also making the neighborhood kind of, you know, a community again, because it was kind of, you know, abandoned to a certain extent. Behind me, you have the Park Slope Food Co-op, which is pretty cool. It's like a supermarket, a little grocery store type thing where you kind of become you buy into it to become a member of it. You have to volunteer your hours as a worker every month. You know, some people will send their nannies, and that's been kind of an issue of contention. But it was actually started by a group of 10 people, including a guy named Joe Holtz, who still kind of works with the co-op, which is pretty nuts. It's been here for like 50 years, 1973. But this kind of stuff is what's started in the neighborhood, and they, you know, start their own co-ops, start their own DIY spaces, art, etc. And it starts to kind of slowly build up. But this was before other neighborhoods in Brooklyn, because the housing stock is so nice, because there's such crazy deals, I guess, on the buildings and things. So this is where it kind of starts to take a turn. And today it's a very fancy neighborhood, you know, because brownstones that people paid $25,000 for are now millions of dollars. Now that's a good investment. So these people who moved into neighborhoods like this were called brownstoners, huh? The original kind of fixer-uppers. But obviously here you have all the brownstones and things. You can't really build the giant glass condo buildings, but you can down near Gowanus Canal. And that's where they're going up today. So the further down you go on the grid, avenue-wise, the more investment you have going in today. Although it's more expensive the closer you get to the park. Shocker. Anyways, guys, that's pretty much the whole way through. Let's go to the next stop and just wrap this thing up, baby. All right, well, we made it to the end, guys. Well, maybe we covered a lot today. We talked about the history of Park Slope, how it started out as basically swampy marsh over near the Gowanus Canal and farms. And then, you know, it got built up after the industry and everything reached this area. You know, became a very fancy neighborhood in the 1800s. Fell into decay after World War II, and now it's being picked back up. Well, actually, it's already been picked up. But that was a pretty good tour. Did you learn something, Stewie?
Learned a lot, man.
Thanks. I know you're not just saying that, but I don't know, maybe you are. Either way, thanks. That being said, guys, if you like the video, please check out the Patreon. Huge help. That's how we fund these things. Once again, that's the game changer, baby. Lots of different levels. Also, like and subscribe. And I don't know what else to say other than, should we go get some acai bowls?
Let's get some acai bowls, man. That sounds delicious.
All right. Well, guys, thanks a lot for watching it. See y'all later.
Thank you.
Sick.